welcome to this time of worship. I am Pastor Alma, the Associate Minister at Shepherd. We are so grateful that you decided to join us at these uncertain times. We hope that wherever you are well and you are feeling blessed. And I want to remind each one of us that there is a special way that God sees us. If you want to repeat with me, please do that. I am chosen. I am blessed. I am loved. If we can share this truth with someone else this week, I am sure they will be blessed by that too. I want to remind you that you are welcome to celebrate special people and occasions in your life with a mission candle and a rosebud. And we will pay attention to those dedications as part of our weekly recordings. The mission candle today shines in loving memory of Dr. Raymond Giverson by B and Family. Also, our mission candle shines in celebration of the 60th wedding anniversary of Don and Diane Stroveling. Our office remains closed in accordance to our governor's order, and our staff is working remotely, coming in only as they must. Our phones will be forwarded to Jody and Jennifer during normal office hours, and we will be available through email. Please share your prayer concerns through a phone call or an email. Remember that we love you and we think of you often, and we are keeping all of you in our prayers as you move through these difficult days. So let us know how we can be of help to you.
Please join me as we sing our opening hymn, number 314, In the Garden. I come to the garden alone, while the dew is still on the roses, and the voice I hear falling on my ear, the Son of God discloses. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. He speaks, and the sound of his voice is so sweet, the birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known. I'll stay in the garden with him, though the night around me be falling, but he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling. And he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. And the joy we share as we tarry there, none other has ever known.
Please join your hearts with mine in this opening prayer. Elusive God, companion on the way, you walk behind, beside, beyond. You catch us unawares. Break through the disillusionment and despair clouding our vision, that with wide-eyed wonder we may find our way and journey on as messengers of your good news. Amen. Please follow me now in the reading of the scripture that comes from the Gospel of Luke, chapter 24, verses 13 through 35. That same day, two of them were walking to the village Emmaus, about 7 miles out of Jerusalem. They were deep in conversation, going over all these things that had happened. In the middle of their talk and questions, Jesus came up and walked along with them, but they were not able to recognize who he was. He asked, "What is this you're discussing so intently as you walk along?" They just stood there, long-faced, like they had lost their best friend. Then one of them, his name was Cleophas, said, "Are you the only one in Jerusalem who hasn't heard what's happened during the last few days?" He said, "What has happened?" They said, "The things that happened to Jesus the Nazarene. He was a man of God, a prophet, dynamic in work and word, blessed by both God and all the people. Then our high priests and leaders betrayed him, got him sentenced to death, and crucified him. And we had our hopes up that he was the one about to deliver Israel. And it is now the third day since it happened. But now some of our women have completely confused us. Early this morning, they were at the tomb and couldn't find his body. They came back with the story that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Some of our friends went off to the tomb to check and found it empty, just as the woman said, but they didn't see Jesus." Then he said to them, "So thick-headed, so slow-hearted, why can't you simply believe all that the prophets said? Don't you see that these things had to happen, that the Messiah had to suffer and only then enter into his glory?" Then he started at the beginning with the books of Moses and went on through all the prophets, pointing out everything in the scriptures that referred to him. They came to the edge of the village where they were headed. He acted as if he were going on, but they pressed him, "Stay and have supper with us. It's nearly evening. The day is done." So he went with them. And here is what happened. He sat down at the table with them. Taking bread, he blessed and broke and gave it to them. At that moment, open-eyed, wide-eyed, they recognized him. And then he disappeared. Back and forth they talked, "Didn't we feel on fire as he conversed with us on the road, as he opened up the scripture for us?" They didn't waste a minute. They were up and on their way back to Jerusalem. They found the 11 and their friends gathered together, talking away. "It's really happened. The Master has been raised up. Simon saw him." Then the two went over everything that happened on the road and how they recognized him when he broke the bread.
Like he'd been there all along. not a stranger, but a father who can sense when something's wrong. And he answered all my questions, and he understood my fear that somehow vanished now that he was here. Can't you see who walks with you? Can't you hear who speaks your name? Can't you feel something stirring in your heart? How his words ring strong and true, like a once familiar strain. Can the paths we follow from now on be the same? I couldn't bear for him to leave me, so I begged him please to stay, spend the evening a few moments before he went his way. Then, like a host, he stood and blessed me, broke the bread and poured the wine. Then I knew there was something I recognized. Yes, I can see who walks with me. I can hear who speaks my name. I can feel something stirring in my heart. How his words ring strong and true, like a once familiar strain. And I know I'll never be the same. I can see, and from the moment in time I felt the emptiness subside, and all the wonder of creation shining through. And for the first time in my life, I really looked into his eyes and saw eternity. And suddenly I knew. Yes, I can see who walks with me. I can hear who speaks my name. I can feel something stirring in my heart. How his words still ring strong and true, like a once familiar strain. And I know I'll never be the same. I can see. I can see. I can see.
Will you pray with me? Now let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. Good morning. My name is Mary, Mary Magdalene, which means I am from the city of Magdala, a city of great wealth, but also a city of great immorality. I met Jesus at the beginning of his career, his ministry. He was very special, and his message was so inspiring. Other women in Galilee, like myself, who had resources, provided for Jesus and for his male disciples. I guess one could say we were patrons, if you will. We were there alongside the male disciples. We were there at the feeding of the 4,000. We were there at the feeding of the 5,000. We were in the temple courtyards. We were in the synagogues. Anywhere Jesus was, we were present. And even though we had to watch sometimes from a distance, we were there. My life had meaning and worth. It was exciting. Every day was an adventure. We never knew what Jesus would do or what he would say. He had such charisma. He was so passionate about the underdog, the people that society had no interest in. He had such a loving heart. Kids were drawn to him. People with chronic illnesses that were embarrassing to talk about snuck up behind to try to touch his robe to receive healing. And he did. He provided what they needed. Jesus was such a loyal friend to me as to Mary and Martha and Lazarus and to his male disciples. But more than that, Jesus was our rabbi, our precious, beloved teacher. After 3 years of preaching and teaching, Jesus announced that he was returning to Jerusalem to celebrate the Passover. When people heard about him, he was so well known and so famous. So when the news came that he was coming, many, many people gathered. And they threw a parade for him, if you will, to honor him. And it was so exciting. We yelled so loud, we practically lost our voices. And there was Jesus sitting on a small colt, his feet dragging in the dirt, waving back at the people, smiling, taking it all in. But there was one thing that didn't quite fit. His eyes were sad. His eyes were somber. Even though his mouth smiled and he was waving, the eyes were somber. Once inside the gate, things began to go awry. Jesus lost his temper and he scattered the money changers' tables. The religious and political leaders, kind of off to the side, were watching Jesus very carefully, just waiting for him to make a mistake, just hoping he would make a mistake. They didn't want a riot. They didn't want things to get completely out of hand because then the Romans would notice and send in an army to squelch, to suppress the uprising. I heard about it later, but Jesus and his 12 disciples met in an upper room to have supper together. Apparently, during that time, Jesus spoke in a very confusing manner. He even talked about dying, and he said somebody was going to betray him. I can only imagine how upsetting that was for my male disciple friends to hear Jesus talk like that. And then the court appearances, the arrests, learning that Peter had denied him 3 times. Peter, of all people? That long walk to Golgotha. They even made Jesus carry his own cross. From a distance, we watched. We watched from a distance as they split up his clothes, as they made fun of him. They put a crown of thorns on his head, taunting him. You know, if you're who you say you are, come on down from the cross. They spat at him. They made fun of him. It was heartbreaking for us to watch and to hear that. And then they put the nails through his hands and through his feet, and they lifted up the cross, and there he hung. We stayed together, my female friends and I, at the base of that cross. We were in despair because we were powerless. We couldn't do anything. Our precious, beloved teacher was dying right before our eyes. Jesus hung his head. It got darker and darker. He began to struggle to breathe, and then The breaths got farther and farther apart. We heard him whispering things. We heard some of them we didn't. And then finally, the breathing stopped. We stayed near him at the foot of the cross. We were crying, praying, trying to sing softly. As we remained there, two of his secret admirers showed up. Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus had received permission to bring the body down and take it off the cross. I was so glad that they showed up to do that. The wrappings of linen were laced, if you will, with the smells of myrrh and aloes, and they wrapped the body of Jesus in that linen with those scents, as is our Jewish custom. There was a garden nearby where Jesus had been crucified, and we understood that there was a tomb, a new tomb that had never been used. And so we followed at a distance and watched Joseph of Arimathea and Nicodemus carry the precious body of our Lord Jesus to the tomb and place it inside. And then they rolled a huge boulder in front of it. And there he remained in the garden. We watched. We couldn't say anything. Jesus was in there behind that big boulder. My heart ached. Jesus. He had changed my life. What an adventure I had with him, because he offered me new life. He offered me abundant life. He healed my physical condition. He gave me a reason to keep living. He provided joy and peace, laughter and hope. And now, his voice silenced. We went home, exhausted and sad from our head to our toes. I felt like we had been abandoned, that we were orphans. We rested on the Sabbath, which is your Saturday, and this is our commandment. On the first day of the week, which is your Sunday, I raced back to the garden where the tomb was. I have to say, I just couldn't stay away. I was eager to come as close as I could to Jesus. I knew he was going to be there behind that big boulder. So I was stunned to see that the stone had actually been rolled over to one side. I couldn't bear to look inside. I just couldn't do it, because had someone stolen the body and hidden it somewhere else? I couldn't bear the thought. I couldn't imagine anything worse, because I wanted a chance to at least anoint the body with the spices that we use to honor the dead, because that's the least I could do for my beloved rabbi. Instead, I turned around and raced to find Peter and the other disciples who Jesus loved. When they heard my message, they sprinted back to the tomb. They slowly peeked inside. The linen wrappings were still there where the body had lain, and the head covering was rolled up into a ball and put to the side. But there was no physical body. There was no body. In disbelief, they backed out of the tomb, fearing the very worst, as I had. And they went home. They ran home to hide, for they were greatly afraid. I stayed for a while, overcome by grief. I felt physically sick. Finally, in despair, I turned to go home, my face covered in tears, but something nudged me to turn around and look one more time, just one more glance. And I did. And my heart leapt. I saw two beautiful, glorious angels sitting on the surface where the linens of Jesus had been placed. Two angels were sitting there now. They looked at me with concern. They wanted to know, why are you crying? And I explained who I was, and I explained while I was there, and I explained how afraid I was that someone had taken his body and hidden it, and I didn't know where it was, and I just was beside myself. I wanted to anoint the body. I wanted to provide that gesture of honor to my beloved rabbi. And I felt the angel's kind eyes smiling at me. Out of the corner of my eye, I noticed yet another man off to the side. And he too wanted to know why I was crying. And again, I explained what had happened and how afraid I was. I really thought he was the gardener. He was the one who was to remain in that area to take care of the greenery, so you will, the flowers that were there around the tombs. He was the gardener. And he seemed concerned about me. And then the gardener softly said something. And I kind of leaned forward, and he said, "Mary, I knew that tone. I knew that voice." I twirled around and I shouted, "Rabboni, my teacher!" I couldn't believe it. He was alive. I could hardly breathe. My heart was racing. I reached out to touch Jesus, but he gently backed away. And instead, he gave me a task. He gave me something to do. He said to me, Go tell the others." Well, of course, I sprang forward and I raced with my feet barely touching the ground. I found my brothers in Christ, the other disciples. I kept repeating, "I've seen the Lord. I've seen the Lord. I have seen the Lord." I just couldn't help myself. And as I ran, I realized that I had been in the garden. I had been the first one to see Jesus alive in the garden. I heard him talk. I heard him, and I saw him physically move around. And my soul just burst wide with joy and with gratitude. He was really, really, truly alive. He stood in front of me in the garden. He called my name. He called my name in the garden. I understand someone actually wrote a hymn about my encounter with Jesus in the garden. And it's my understanding that at the beginning of your gathering today, you sang that hymn. I'm so glad. Because he walks with me, and he talks with me, and he tells me I am his own. He called me by name. My encounter with Jesus in the garden. My sisters and brothers in Christ, listen for his voice. He is calling you today also. Draw near. Walk with him. Talk with him. Be surrounded by his love, his peace, his joy. Christ is risen. He really is. I saw him there in the garden. My encounter with Jesus Christ in the garden changed my life forever. But wait until you hear what happened to my friend Cleopas and one of his friends as they were leaving Jerusalem and returning home to Emmaus. Let's join Cleopas and his unnamed friend as they walk. And perhaps you'd enjoy pretending that you are the unnamed friend walking alongside Cleopas. Together, you and Cleopas are remembering the events of the past week, a very confusing, distressing week. You both had expected great things from the prophet Jesus of Nazareth. But the chief priests and leaders had tricked him. They'd ask him questions he wouldn't answer. They brought him before a crowd. The crowd chose Barabbas, and Jesus was crucified. You had hoped that he would be the one to finally redeem the people of Israel, to overthrow the powerful Roman government, to throw them over, to reclaim your beloved Jerusalem as your own. Jesus had been a powerful speaker. He was very charismatic, an amazing healer. He even walked on top of the water, and while in a boat with his disciples during a terrible storm at sea, he calmed the waters. He even raised his dear friend Lazarus from the dead. I mean, Lazarus had lain in the tomb for 4 days. 4 days. Can you imagine? What's the word? Lazarus was, how shall we say, odoriferous? You really thought Jesus was the one, but you've been waiting and it's already been 3 days. Already 3 days. And then all the strange stories about what happened after the crucifixion. Some women were at the tomb this morning in the garden, and they couldn't find the body. And then they raced to tell the disciples, and they raced back, and they were scared, and they left, and they hid. But Mary saw Jesus in the garden, and he was alive. He talked to her. These are crazy, crazy stories. For you and Cleopas, it would be like reading today's tabloids. It was like one outrageous story after another. You couldn't believe it. You didn't know what to believe. You didn't know if it was fake news or the real thing. It was very distressing. So, when another man joined you and Cleopas, you were amazed that he hadn't heard about all the events of the past week or of that morning. He must be the only person alive who hadn't heard. Today we might have said something like, "What's wrong with you, sir? Are you living your life with your head buried in the sand like an ostrich?" I mean, we just couldn't believe. He just didn't know what had happened. He seemed oblivious to the world around him. But then that stranger who joined you and Cleopas began to speak. And he went all the way back to Moses and then the other prophets, and he made the connections between what had been predicted or prophesied and the crazy events of this last week in Jerusalem. He connected them together. He interpreted the scriptures. He interpreted the prophecies and reminded both of you that, according to scripture, when the Messiah came, it would be necessary for him to suffer. To suffer. There was going to be suffering before any sort of glory, before any sort of happy ending. It was all there in the scriptures. I'm guessing that you and Cleopas were pretty impressed with his knowledge. He was obviously a very learned rabbi who seemed, I don't know, a little bit familiar. So when the three of you arrived at Emmaus and the stranger looked like he was going to keep on walking, heading out of the village, if you will, you and Cleopas persuaded him to stay because the day was almost over and the evening was coming, and you wanted perhaps to provide some hospitality, feed him something, give him something to drink, but also you wanted him to stay because he was just so interesting and so knowledgeable, and he was just a little bit familiar, and you couldn't quite put your finger on it. During your meal with him, the stranger picked up a loaf of bread, and then he blessed the bread, and you stopped. There was only one person in your life that had done that way. Could it be? Could it really be? And in a flash, all the pieces of the puzzle fell into place. Who else would have interpreted the scriptures so eloquently and so clearly? Who else would have stayed with you long enough so that you and Cleopas could figure it out? You had been so upset by the events of the past week. You had been so disoriented, so confused, so overwhelmed with all the information and all the things that had happened that you couldn't even recognize him. You were blind to the presence of the risen Lord, that stranger walking right next to you. And so the stranger did what he needed to do. He reminded you and Cleopas at great length of the prophecies, interpreting, making sense, connecting all those dots. And you had a funny inkling that this stranger was familiar. Your hearts were burning inside you, kind of like with an indigestion, I would think. And there was a red flag waving in your brain, you know, pay attention, pay attention, pay attention. You know who this is, pay attention. Yes, there was just something familiar. But it wasn't until Jesus sat at your table and slowly picked up that bread and quietly blessed it. And then you and Cleopas saw the clouds of doubt and confusion and sadness over the events of the week parted. They lifted. And you saw. You saw with the eyes of faith. You saw Jesus. No longer a stranger, but Jesus, your Lord and Savior, sitting at that table with you, eating bread and drinking wine with you. He was right there. And then, as soon as the two of you had figured it out, he vanished. But your heart continued to be warmed. But that's okay that he vanished, because the story is just beginning. You raced back the 7 miles from Emmaus to Jerusalem and shared your experience with the others. It was a fabulous time because you found out that Jesus had been appearing here and there to lots of different people. And it was so exciting because people didn't know where he was going to show up next or what he was going to do. For Cleopas and you, he knew what you needed that morning on the road after having left Jerusalem and all of those horrific events behind. He knew that you needed him to show up and to provide explanations to help you make sense of it, to connect the dots. He needed for you to know that he was the risen Christ. And so he broke bread and he blessed the bread. And in that gesture, you moved from doubt to wondering who that was, to thinking it might be someone familiar, to great joy, belief, hope, excitement. You moved from doubt to belief. My sisters and brothers in Christ, what do you need Jesus to provide for you this morning so that your heart might be reassured and your hope and your trust strengthened? Jesus loves you as much as he loved Mary to Magdalene, as much as he loved Cleopas, as much as he loved his disciples, Peter who denied him. He loves you as much. You are chosen. You are blessed and you are loved. He provided what they needed and he can do that for you as well. Like Mary Magdalene and Cleopas, you too can encounter Jesus the Christ in your daily journey through life, on your road, so to speak. Mary came looking. She was searching. She came to the garden, and Jesus was present. Jesus was there for her. He recognized her. He called her by name, which is what she needed. Jesus provided for Mary. Cleopas and his friend were searching for meaning and understanding after a very confusing week. Jesus joined them on their road. On that road to Emmaus, and made things clear, and made things amazingly crystal clear. Jesus provided for them what they needed. We too are in a time of confusion, of uncertainty. The events of the last few weeks have been unsettling and unnerving, and our future too is unknown. As a church, as a national church, as a worldwide church, how we are going to deal with and recover and help each other with the pandemic. We too need Jesus. But there is a stranger walking alongside each of us, and he's not a stranger. We know that. He is Jesus, the risen Christ. He is our Lord, and he walks and he talks with us, and he tells me we are his own, even in these times. It is Jesus, our risen Lord. He's simply waiting for you to recognize him. Our prayer might be, Lord, give us the eyes and the ears and the heart to truly see and to truly feel your presence as you walk this journey with us. May we see with eyes of faith that you are alive and that you are here, and you walk and you talk with us and you call us to be your own. Amen.
This is a time for us to join in prayer for people in our lives, people in our church, and in our communities. Please join me in prayer. God of wonder, we have come to you as people who cannot know and understand everything, but people who can trust that you see what is hidden from us. We come as people with a world that experiences so much loss at this time. God, help us, as our plans that we had for this time were not able to be completed, as we have loss of incomes, loss of connections, loss of lives. We are asking that you help us walk through these times with a hope that is renewed in us. And we're asking that at this time, you bless especially those who, on top of everything, are having to deal with war and violence in their own homes and natural disasters and other things that make life so much difficult. God, we ask that you help us deepen our conversations with you and with each other at this time, that we can use our time wisely, that we allow your spirit to move in us individually and collectively, so that the special work that you can do in our lives at times like this can happen. Make us ready, God, for whatever is that you are doing in your world. We thank you for your many blessings in the midst of our challenges. We thank you for your love, for your presence for our loved ones. Thank you, God, for the food we have, for the things that gives us comfort at this time. We pray in the name of Jesus, who is the one who resurrected from the dead to give us all life. Amen. And now I invite you to join in the Lord's Prayer as we sing with Ken, wherever we are.
Kingdom.
To the end of our service, I would offer these closing words. As we walk through this next week, may our eyes, our ears, and our hearts be alert to Christ's presence. May we, like Cleopas and his friend, encounter Jesus on the road, on the journey of our day-to-day life. But unlike them, may we be able to recognize quickly and joyfully our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Now, in gratitude for this good news, let's sing together our closing hymn, He Lives. It's number 310.
I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever foes may say. I see His hand of mercy. I hear His voice of cheer. And just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives. Appearing will come at last. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my O Christian, lift up your voice and sing eternal hallelujahs to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good and kind. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. Talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make His face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up His countenance upon you and give you His peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.